Thank you very much for your kind introduction, and I'm very happy and pleased to return here again in this part of the world and enjoy the pleasant climate in Natal and also this institute. So I'm very happy that there's such a large crowd here, that the whole room is completely full. Okay, so I have a story to tell, and the story is about black holes, and I'd like to tell it to everybody who wants to listen. And this is a slide, the favorite slide of my wife, because she says this is makes it quite clear what you're talking about. I am an elementary particle physicist, and you could ask, why are elementary particle physicists interested in black holes? Well, what you see here is something that looks like a highway with signposts on both sides. At the left, you see how much energy you need to put in an elementary particle. At the left, you see signposts saying how much energy you need per elementary particle to uncover details of physics that live at that part of the world. At the right, you see how big those things are. So here you see sizes in meters, and you see there are factors of thousands all the time. Factor 1,000 smaller at the right, and factor 1,000 bigger at the left. And today, we are just only about here. And the costs of making experimental machines go even faster than factors of 1,000. So you can imagine if some source of money comes along with factor 1,000,000 times more than now, then we can make two steps in here. And but that's not so easy. So we are theoretical physicists, and as theoretical physicists, we have no difficulty imagining the world way on top of this highway. And you also see some other words there. GUT stands for Grand Unified Theory, the fundamental theory of where all forces seem to become equal in strength. If you extrapolate today's understanding of the forces, they all become about equal in strength here. And this is where we expect certainly new physics, perhaps superstrings, and eventually black holes, because this is where the gravitational force starts to mix in with the other forces and become equally important, or more important even than the other forces. And that also means that all the forces associated to the formation of black holes will start to arrive here. And indeed, at that energy and at that size, you expect elementary particles to become black holes. And now, you might think that large size objects consist of small size objects. So small size objects are more basic, we think. Nobody is sure about this, but this is a natural way of thinking, that small things are made out of, big things are made out of small things. So maybe all the elementary particles are eventually made out of black holes, if you look at it this way. So we like to understand it, and the problem is we don't. We don't really understand, not at least as well as you would like to understand, how the gravitational force actually works at this very top of the highway. So for instance, you can ask the question, if there's a problem with understanding the gravitational force, well, maybe it's a good idea to look at those parts of the universe where the gravitational force is as strong as it ever can be. Can you hear me like this? Okay. So where are the strongest gravitational forces? Well, certainly in black holes, but the tinier the black hole, the stronger the force is at its immediate vicinity. So if you want to know really where does the gravitational force become extraordinarily strong, it is at these very tiniest black holes. We have reasons to believe that black holes cannot become tinier than those sizes, because then you would need then you would not know where you would be sitting at the highway. So probably the strongest black holes are those, the strongest gravitational fields occur in black holes which are at the top of that highway. So if we understand that, then maybe we understand the laws of physics that we have to formulate in that domain. So perhaps the best way to understand how the gravitational force has to be included in our understanding of elementary particles is to study those black holes. And we can also phrase things the following way. There are various fundamental constants of nature. The speed of light is very fundamental. It occurs everywhere in the physical world. If you study the universe, then the speed of light just tells you how fast information from outer stars is reaching us. But if you study elementary particles, it tells you how fast elementary particles can go. And at these velocities, very strange things happen, described by special relativity. So the speed of light, c, is obviously very important. But then there's also the gravitational force, Newton's constant, which sits here. And then there is a constant here, h with a little bar through it, h bar. And that's Planck's constant, the constant that tells you how strong quantum mechanical effects are. And now we can say, wait a minute, all these constants have dimension. You can express it in terms of kilograms, meters, and seconds. But they all three come in a different combination of kilograms, meters, and seconds. So if you work a little bit on that, you can find a new system of units by taking the appropriate combination of these constants. You take the square root of h bar times Newton's constant, and you divide by c to the third, you get something which has a dimension of a length. And that length is 10 to the minus 33 centimeters. If you think that the chips in your mobile phone are very small, yes, they are small, but not hardly as small as that. That is, in fact, smaller than the tiniest particles that we can study. It's indeed a lot smaller than the tiniest particles we can study. It's the smallest distance scale in physics that we can imagine. The mass unit is more interesting. It's 20 micrograms. Maybe you think that that is a reasonable amount of mass. But for the elementary particle physicist, that is an enormous amount of mass. Think of how many elementary particles do you have to put together to get something with the mass of 20 micrograms. That is a lot. So 20 micrograms is very large for a particle physicist. Of course, very, very small for someone who does astronomy. But that's the way these are. This unit of time is even more ridiculous. So this unit of time here, 10 to the minus 44 seconds. If someone wants to sell you a computer saying that its switching time is faster than 10 to the 44 switches per second, don't buy it because he's lying. You can't make anything that fast today. This is the Planck time unit. So these are fundamental units, and those are the units that are relevant at the very top end of the highway. We have reasons to think that the highway will not continue. It goes on into a space-time that is not well structured anymore. So we cannot imagine how the highway will continue. But if we understand physics at the very end of that highway, maybe we can extrapolate all the other laws of physics in a unique fashion. That is our hope. So now, black holes, the study of black holes underwent a complicated and interesting modification when one guy who was very famous studied this. This is Stephen Hawking. He is standing in between Albert Einstein and Isaac Newton, as you can see. Newton and Einstein, and this is an episode in Star Trek where, due to some warp in space and time, they just meet each other together, and they start to play a game of poker there. And those two are actors, but this is the real person. And there are stories to tell about this, but I have no time for that. I'll just continue with what he noted about black holes, something very, very fundamental. I haven't really told you yet what a black hole is. A black hole is this kind of extreme bunch of gravitational forces that you get if matter attracts itself gravitationally so strongly that nothing can stop it anymore. This happens in heavy stars and inside heavy galaxies, where a black hole of several solar masses, or hundreds or thousands or billions of solar masses, can be formed. And those amounts of mass are so big that the gravitational force is so strong that nothing can stop it. And then you go through a magic line, a frontier here, this is the sign, the edge of the black hole. When you reach that edge, there's nothing that can stop you anymore. So for instance, if an astronaut would enter into that black hole, you would think the astronaut would go straight through. But when you look, when you consider someone looking at a black hole from a distance, that person would actually think that astronaut stops right at the horizon. He doesn't go through that horizon at all. He stops right there. And the reason is that the deeper you are in the gravitational field, the slower time goes. So that this magic barrier of the black hole is a barrier where time stands still. If you go through it, does time go backwards? No, it's even more crazy. Time goes in the imaginary direction. It's very strange what happens beyond that barrier. But the astronaut himself will not agree with this. The astronaut himself will just say that I'm going straight through the barrier and I'm exploring the other side. This is a fundamental feature of the gravitational field, that different observers see different features of their surrounding space-time. So we see the astronaut stops at the horizon, but a distant observer sees the astronaut go. No, the distant observer sees the astronaut stop at the horizon. The astronaut himself thinks he goes straight through. And that implies that they experience time differently. And I'll now explain to you why that implies that since the notion of time is experienced so differently by these two observers, also the notion of elementary particles is conceived differently. When one of these two sees a particle, the other one sees something else. And I'll tell you in a minute what they will see. First of all, that magic barrier is not so magic at all. Think of the region of the North Pole on planet Earth. And think of the coordinate system that you like to use, which is longitude and latitude. Now, longitude and latitude are well-defined coordinates everywhere on planet Earth, in particular on Natal, which is there at the bottom somewhere. And but also in my country, latitude and longitude are well-defined coordinates. But they're no longer well-defined on the North Pole. You don't know what latitude is. Now imagine a polar bear comes, and a polar bear stands right on top of the North Pole. And now we say, wait a minute, stop there, because we don't know what your longitude and latitude is anymore. Well, latitude perhaps we do, but longitude is ill-defined. The polar bear says, I don't care. He just doesn't know what we're talking about. He doesn't understand anyway. So he just continues his way right through the North Pole, and nothing happens to him. So, of course, it's all a question of coordinates. So, in principle, nothing happens. There's nothing special at that point at all. The same is true for the horizon of a black hole. A polar bear can go to the horizon of a black hole and go right through, and being a polar bear, he doesn't know what he's doing, and he doesn't notice anything out of the ordinary when he goes through that horizon. So, here comes a polar bear again, sits right on top there, and nothing happens to him. But for the distant observer, time is like the concept of longitude on the planet Earth. So time stands still. Longitude is ill-defined on the North Pole, and time is in the same way ill-defined on the horizon of a black hole. In fact, if you want to go through, the time for the polar bear just is those red lines there. But the polar bear seems to be going into a region of the black hole that cannot be seen at all by the outside observer. That's when the polar bear falls into the black hole. So, in quantum field theories now, when we understand, when we try to describe elementary particles, we need a field. Now, this is the most technical part of my talk. If you can't follow me here, don't worry. I'll not use this very much. But this is for the physicist. If you take a field which depends on the coordinates, longitude and latitude or whatever, then we in particle physics like to Fourier the field in terms of time t. And this omega is so-called Fourier parameter, so Fourier coefficient. And there's a function a of omega which tells you what the Fourier coefficient is. Now, what is special about this is that A of omega multiplies a st- state of the world with a factor e to the I omega t. Physicists know that means that the energy after the action of this operator, the energy has decreased by an amount omega, or h bar omega. Here, the energy increases by an amount h bar omega. This is the opposite operator. So we say this is an annihilation operator that annihilates the amount omega out of the energy. And this operator creates an amount omega in the energy. And the polar bear knows nothing about quantum field theory, but you think, imagine a physicist there who wants to know what an elementary particle is. He Fourier transforms this. But he uses those red coordinates for the local time to define A omega and A dagger of omega. But the distant observer uses his distant notion of time to define those things, which, like the longitude of on the planet Earth, is ill-defined. So the particle for the distant observer at that spot where the ice bear, polar bear is sitting is ill-defined. So this is the reason why different observers define particles differently. And positive omega and negative omega mix when you go from one observer to the other observer. Now, and now comes a nice thing that is always sort of a relief, that actually is something very simple. We're talking about the vacuum state, the empty state, the state with no particles. What's the definition of a state with no particles? That is a state out of which you cannot remove any particle because there isn't anything there. So you cannot, in particular, reduce the energy any further. The energy is lowest that you can ever get if you have the vacuum state. That means that if I take this operator A of omega on the vacuum state, you get zero, because you can't do it. You get the zero state. But that is only true if omega is positive. If omega is negative, then you're creating particles. And if you have the vacuum, you can always put a particle there. So putting a particle there is fine, but trying to remove a particle from the vacuum doesn't work. So A of omega is zero, but A dagger of omega is not zero. But now the two observers disagree about the definition of omega, of A of omega in particular. So they also disagree about what the vacuum state is. So when the polar bear sees a vacuum, the outside observer sees particles. That was Hawking's discovery. So there are particles there. Hawking thought, by the way, in the beginning when he first hit upon this question, that he was making a mistake. He said, I'm doing something wrong. I don't get the right vacuum out when I calculate black hole. But then he asked a very ingenious question. Then he asked, let's calculate how many particles there are in as seen by the distant observer. And he did that calculation, turned out to be not so very hard. And he found something amazing. He found that the total particles that come out are just like the photons emitted by a light bulb. So imagine, if you switch on a light bulb, photons come out, and the photons are actually representative for the temperature of the glowing line fiber inside the light bulb. So light is characterized by temperature. And so Hawking discovered that the radiation that is emitted by a black hole due to this mechanism is also characterized by temperature. For a black hole as heavy as the sun, it's 10 to the minus 8 Kelvin. That's a very low temperature. But that's only because the black hole is so big. The wavelength characteristic for that temperature is then 3 kilometers for a black hole the size of the sun. But if the black hole becomes lighter, becomes smaller, the temperature will increase. So if the black hole becomes much, much lighter than the sun, this becomes a large number, and then the temperature rapidly increases. So the next step he immediately took, like all other physicists also agreed about, that if the black hole emits particles, it must lose mass, because there's mass and there's energy. The mass goes into the particles that it ejects. So whatever, there must be less mass left when the particles are being emitted. So eventually, a black hole will decrease in size and decrease in mass because of that. When it decreases in mass, the gravitational, the radiation increases. The temperature increases, the radiation increases. Radiation goes to the fourth power of the temperature. So in spite of the black hole becoming smaller, the intensity of its radiation increases. It loses mass faster. And you can imagine at the last moment, the amount of mass and energy lost by the black hole is so tremendously big the whole thing will explode by a gigantic explosion. And you can calculate how much energy it is. Well, that's the mass of a small mountain that during a fraction of a second is transformed into energy. That is a gigantic explosion. You should see that from many light years distance. So Hawking then asked astronomers, do you see flashes of energy at very large distances? Astronomer says, yes, you see that. We call that gamma bursts. But the gamma ray bursts turned out to always be associated with galaxies. So they must come from very, very big objects inside galaxies. In fact, from very big black holes inside galaxies. So they were not what Hawking hoped that he would discovered decaying black holes, but it could have been so. In short, the outcome of this story is that a black hole can absorb things, astronauts, fish, or crazy people can go into a black hole, but the black hole then also emits particles at a certain rate, at a certain temperature. And for a particle physicist, it looks very nice. This gives us the impression that black hole is not an immortal thing, it's not something out of the divine domain of the gravitational force. No, it's matter. If I take a bucket of water, I can add more water to it, or I can pour water out of it, or I can let it evaporate and the water. So the black hole starts to look more and more like a bucket of water. And so it is something for which we have to write down the laws of nature. And you might now... yes, I should. This is what I said before. Black holes now seem to be just like elementary particles. That think of a heavy atomic nucleus like uranium. You can make uranium by fusing lighter elements together, and like what happens in a star or in heavy nuclear reactions. But the uranium atom is not absolutely stable. After a while, it decays again by fission. It falls apart and it emits particles. So particles go in and particles go out. So you can write this thing in what we call Feynman diagrams that we're used to in particle physicists. You say, this is a Feynman diagram. It says these green lines are the various forms of matter that implode to make a black hole. Then a black hole forms. And then a black hole slowly decays by emitting particles. And that happens with a gigantic bang at the very end. And so this whole thing is like a Feynman diagram. And we in particle physics, we are used to working with Feynman diagrams. So yes, this should allow us to compute everything and to include black holes in our picture of elementary particles. We know we can calculate how strongly particles are being absorbed. We can calculate how strongly particles are being emitted. Isn't that great? So now we have a missing piece of information about the end of the I wave. We didn't have to do any experiment. This comes out of pure reasoning, pure thinking. However, there's a problem with this pure thinking. And that is, there are certain things we can calculate, which is how many states can the black hole be in? Now that sounds very surprising. How can we figure that one out? Well, when we teach graduate students how to do quantum field theory, you tell them, if you want to know how intensive a certain reaction is, you need to compute two things. You need to compute a quantum amplitude, which tells you how a wave function transcends into another wave function. But you also need to know the size of the phase space. The size of the phase space says, how many final states can the thing be in? And the more final states there are, the more intense the reaction takes place. So if you compute the decay of an elementary particle, for instance, into other particles, you have to say how many states can the other particles be in. If that's a lot of space, decay goes very fast. If the amount of space is very little, decay goes slowly. So this way you get information about phase space if you know those interactions. And I just said before that, yes, you can compute how often particles can be absorbed by a black hole and how much time it takes for the thing to emit particles. If you put this information together, you get out information about phase space of a black hole. And that means that a black hole looks something like this, that it's an interacting object, but there are bits and bytes on its surface, and you can count them. The bits and bytes follow some rule of nature. I don't know, I just made something up to make this picture. But these bits and bytes, maybe blinking bits and bytes, they do something, they absorb some things in the black hole, and they make the black hole emit things. And the nice thing about this argument is it tells us how many blinking squares you can put on the surface area of the black hole. Not very surprisingly, the outcome of that is that this is roughly the Planck length squared. So the Planck length square is the amount of space a little square, elementary blinking square, takes on the black hole, regardless how big or small the black hole is. The black hole can be very big, it has very large phase space, but it can be very small, it has a small phase space. It is this number, but there's also a number on the side. This is a number of bits and bytes that all black holes have in common. All black holes that you can make transitions to each other will have the same number of bits and bytes on the side. So we don't know this number, but we know that number goes proportional to the surface area. So, okay, now we're in a very good position to compute everything. So now we should be able to compute exactly how the black hole behaves. And we can bring law and order in the behavior of the black hole. This we describe quantum mechanically by an operator U that tells you how the thing evolves in time. I don't have a Schrödinger equation for the black hole, or all these things. Now, this led to a problem. First of all, we discovered that we cannot do the computation as nicely as we want. We'd like to be able to compute in which states the black hole can be in, and how these states specify how they absorb things and how they emit things. We discovered we're at a loss. This argument was too indirect, so somehow we cannot compute these things as nicely as you want. And then we discover that we're hitting a very fundamental problem. Because if the evolution operator of a black hole is described quantum mechanically, it means that different instates always produce different outstates. So this U stands for unitary, which really means that if the norm of quantum states of the in particles will be the same as the norm of the quantum states of the out particles, it has to be, probability has to be preserved. But if you combine this with the laws of quantum mechanics, then you see that this is a very stringent restriction that the black hole must obey. Then you try to compute that, it doesn't work that way. And the reason is, if something falls into a black hole, you lose all trace of it. You can't compute anything anymore about what it does. So it looks as if the future behavior of a black hole doesn't depend on what you threw in. But that's impossible if there is such an operator. So we hit upon a problem, and it was called the black hole information problem. So something didn't work in our equation. There's something basically wrong. And this led to something we call a paradox. How do the Hawking particles depend on the particles that went into the black hole? According to Hawking himself, who was the first who derived this property, he said, not at all. It doesn't depend on the things going in. And if you don't like that, well, this is the way it comes out of the calculation. But if that is so, then the black hole as an object, as a bucket, like a bucket of water, would disobey the laws of quantum mechanics. But then all the particle physicists said, wait a minute, you used quantum mechanics to derive this property. And now your answer is something that disobeys quantum mechanics. That cannot be true. There's something wrong here. And well, this led to a big discussion about which Lenny Susskind wrote a book. He called the book The Black Hole War. The war with particle physics on one hand, and everyone did general relativity on the other. So general relativity was a subject of Stephen Hawking, and it had become a very different branch of physics. So people didn't realize that these two different branches of physics now had to talk to each other, and they came with a different result. And so he calls it the black hole war. I don't like the word war in the book. It's discussion, a fight perhaps, but we still stay friends nevertheless, even though we disagree about some details here. So it was my battle with Stephen Hawking to make the world safe for quantum mechanics. That was what he called his book. And there were now a number of options. Someone has to give a little bit. And one possibility is that indeed quantum coherence, quantum mechanics itself, gets lost. A fundamental feature of quantum mechanics is that if you have a coherent state, it stays a coherent state, unless you have some influence from the outside. If you don't, it must stay coherent. But for the black hole, according to Hawking, that was not what's happening. It emits thermally, like a light bulb that's not coherent. So the possibility could be that the information could somehow be kept after the black hole radiates all its energy away. Something must be staying there to keep all the information. They call that the black hole remnant. Remnant is whatever is left after the thing decays. It can't decay to the vacuum, because that would be forbidden by quantum mechanics. Something else. But maybe there's, then the particle physicists said, no, that can't be true. Those remnants would violate all the laws of particle physics that we know. So that cannot be correct. Something must be wrong. Now, the third option is that somehow the information does return, but disguised as Hawking particles. So the particles come out of the black hole. Those particles must contain the information that went in. Except we don't know how, but that's our problem. We have to solve that. But the information will be there. And finally, related to that could be the option that information returns immediately. So the Hawking particles contain all the information and about the ingoing particles. And that could be the way in which black hole is unitary. Well, Hawking started with this attitude, but then he made some changes and he announced that he was changing his mind about it. And he made the announcement again. So he is now at that spot. And Susskind and me, I think we are here somewhere. In fact, this difference is minute, so I think we are coming close together now. Why is it that particle physicists say that the information does not have to get lost? Well, again, I draw here the surface, the horizon of a black hole, now as a horizontal surface for a moment, that the gravitational field is now pointing downwards. And I imagine that a particle goes in. The particle that goes in, as seen by the distant observer, goes in slower and slower and slower. And the distant observer never sees a particle go in through the horizon. So it just sits closer and closer to the horizon, ingoing particle. And then there's an outgoing particle, goes out like that. It never was beyond the horizon. It just comes out, starts out being very, very close to the horizon, and then gradually manages to get itself loose and goes off to infinity. So are these things independent? Well, yes, except they might interact at this spot. And then particle physicists and relativists all said that must be impossible, that must be not the answer, because this interaction is too weak. If you look at particle physics, the way we do it is you consider this interaction as a small perturbation. If that is a small perturbation, that cannot be the fundamental answer to this difficult question about where the information is. So this is wrong, they said. Well, except that the gravitational force becomes very strong when you take these particles to become very close together. So the gravitational force is the one exception. It's not such a weak force near the horizon of the black hole. And this is how I can illustrate that. So here are now all the Hawking particles waiting to get out. They're sitting in a long queue like when you go through customs at the airport, but they can't get out. They only get out one by one after a very long amount of time. So they're all queuing in and then queuing out. And then there's ingoing particles which are going in, but as seen by the polar bear, they actually do go through the horizon. But what do? They gravitationally interact with the other particles and do it this way. They drag them along a little bit. So look what's happening. The ingoing particles drag the outgoing particles along in. Now you see that some particles actually disappeared. If you look carefully, a few particles were dragged in completely. Well, that means that this is a fundamentally different state from what it was before. Some particles are missing. So now that is sufficient to save unitarity. And I've always claimed that this must be the answer, although we don't know all the details yet, but this must be the answer to the problem. But that means that the momentum of the ingoing particles determines how strong this dragging force is. At the same time, it influences the positions of the arc particles. And now we notice here something peculiar that rings a bell to everybody who works with quantum mechanics. They say, wait a minute, this is an interaction that mixes up momentum with position. In quantum mechanics, there's an uncertainty relation between momentum and position. What is happening here? Something very interesting is happening here. The outgoing particles turn out to be dependent on the ingoing particles in a very special and subtle way. But if you want to relate momentum with position, you first have to write down a quantum wave function and say the wave function is centered around this spot, but then the number of oscillations of the wave function determine the momentum. That's again the Fourier transform. So we could say that the outgoing particles are the Fourier transforms of the ingoing particles. And now the nice thing is that you can do this calculation. And to do this calculation, you have to use a trick that's also nearly 100 years old, or older in fact, when people solved the hydrogen atom. And the Schrödinger came with the Schrödinger equation, and he solved the hydrogen atom, and he used spherical waves, spherical harmonics. So these are different resonances any spherical object can be in. You use the spherical harmonics, which are mathematical functions called y sub lm. Never mind if you don't follow all the details, but if you write the ingoing particles in terms of these spherical harmonics, like people also do with when they study the seismic waves on the planet Earth, that you can arrange the seismic waves as if there are combinations of such spherical harmonics. This is what you have to do with the electric particles. Because then, if the ingoing particles are in a particular spherical harmonic, then the outgoing particles are in the same spherical harmonic. And that implies that the calculation can be made a lot easier and understandable. So something comes out that you can now calculate. It all looks fine except for one little thing. Here comes the Hawking radiation, comes out of the black hole. This is where the polar bear could go through, but a distant observer sees some similarity. Here comes the Hawking particle out. And now we have an extra ingoing particle. That's this. But now the ingoing particle drags along the outgoing particle. And this is Hawking particle that is being dragged back in again. So this calculation with the spherical harmonics is fine, but what do we do with those particles that are going in? So I was very interested in this question, did the calculation. And then the calculation said, okay, there seems to be a good answer out of this calculation, but I realized I'd made a mistake, because the mistake was that I presumed that the outgoing particles should go in that direction, but the calculations come out very easy and nice if it comes out in this direction. Now here, this is the horizon of the black hole. This is the black hole. What's this region? Well, that's the interior of the black hole. This is where the Hawking particles come from. And that's where you go. That's your destiny. You fall into a black hole. It'll be somewhere here. But what does it mean that things go backwards in this direction? Well, time goes backwards in this direction. So here you see, if you go through the horizon like this, you have to go faster than the local speed of light. Then you enter to another domain where time runs backwards. So the horizon separates a region where time runs forward from a region where time runs backwards. And the calculation comes out beautiful and unitary if you assume that the outgoing wave goes in this direction. But then there's a problem. And the problem is with the relation between momentum and position. So suppose that the ingoing particle has a definite position. It's very strongly peaked at a spot outside the horizon. This is the ingoing particle. Then the outgoing particle is being dragged along, but the dragging is associated with a Fourier transformation. You have to go from position to momentum or from momentum to position. So if the position is very sharp, the momentum is not sharp at all. So that means that the outgoing particle is the Fourier transform, whatever you have here. And that's a wave function which can sit in this region and in this region. In fact, the dominant domain sits here. That's because the particle went into the black hole. So there's a peak here, but there's a small part of the wave function that sits here. And now the question is how to do the calculation correctly. The nice thing about the spherical wave expansion was that the calculation became so transparent. You can understand what you're doing. It's exactly as easy or as difficult as solving the hydrogen atom. So if you're an undergraduate student and you haven't yet solved the hydrogen atom, you'll think it's very complicated. And then this answer is also complicated. But if you have done the hydrogen atom and discovered actually it's not so hard, then you do the spherical wave expansion, then this is also similarly rather easy. So there was this other region. I labeled region 2, if you remember. Should we go back for a moment? Yes. I labeled 1, 2, 3, 4. Four domains of the universe surrounding a black hole. And Hawking asked, of course, also the question, what is that region 2? And he said, that's another black hole, because it looks exactly like the black hole you work with, but it sits somewhere else in the universe. But now, with this Fourier transform business, it means that the particle going in may go out in this other universe. And Hawking said, yes, it's great, isn't it nice? So you can make interstellar travel. You go from one black hole to another black hole. But now, if you look at this calculation, it doesn't come out the way we would expect it in physics, because now you can send information from one black hole to another black hole. Something seems to be basically wrong with that idea. So to make the calculation tick and to make the whole thing fit in a theory that you could understand, we had to say something about that region too. So Hawking liked it that you can make interstellar travel, and also all these movies. There was a recent movie about humanity going through a black hole to another star system. That's fine if you want to make science fiction movies. It's not so fine if you want to do good physics. Then you need to do something else. And so region 2 seems to be exactly like region 1 for a black hole. What is it? And think a little bit and say, well, there is actually one very, very natural answer to that. It's just the other side. So the black hole has two sides. If I go in here, I may reappear at the other side of the black hole. When you do the mathematics, you discover something else, which is it's exactly the only solution that works. Exactly that. You have to go to the antipodes. So I didn't think of looking up what the antipode of Natal is. Somewhere in Siberia or so. Anyway, every point on Earth has a point. If you look straight down, there's another point on Earth that's called the antipode. So if you fall through the black hole this way, you emerge at the antipode. And that picture works amazingly well. Actually, of course, when you see such a thing, you discover this idea was announced long ago by Sanchez and Whiting, who proposed that you must identify points on the horizon of a black hole opposite to each other, the antipodal identification. And now this is the picture of the black hole. I could have given this earlier. Mathematically, the black hole looks like having one universe, which is a little bit curved because of the gravitational field. But when gravitational implosion takes place for making a black hole, it actually makes connects our universe with another universe. It's a kind of shadow universe where the black hole also sits, and you have a wormhole from one universe to the other universe. The wormhole is also sometimes called the Einstein-Rosen bridge. So it's normally thought that the bridge connects one universe to another universe. But now I'm saying, no, it's not that other universe. It's just the other side. That makes a lot of sense. It seems, at first you might think, well, but that means that you go faster than the speed of light, one side of the black hole to the other side of the black hole. Is that not wrong? Well, not really, because the black hole itself gives you a reference frame, so you're not violating special relativity. Also, to go through the horizon to the other side, it's a fairly long journey in the beginning to come close to the horizon, because like the polar bear, you're slowing down enormously before you actually reach that point. And to get out also takes an enormous amount of time. So you lose lots of time if you make this journey through the horizon of black hole to go to the other side, apart from interchanging position with momentum. It's a very strange feature. But there doesn't seem to be any straight contradiction there. So to give a picture, this is again the wormhole seen in a different way. The universe got deformed, but so much that it makes a throat to another part of the universe is actually space, a space-time picture. And now the proposal is that this is too much. That's another universe. You have to wipe out part of that and say that if you want to, if you are going there, you actually, from that circle there, you jump instantaneously from there to there, and then you go back into the other side of the black hole. So the other side of the black hole just sits behind this. So I travel the green line, then make a jump, and then I do not travel in this direction, I travel in that direction again. So another way of picturing this is that you might imagine the black hole as being a region of space and time where a sphere has been excavated. The sphere is removed from space and time in such a way that if you go, you enter this point here, you make an instantaneous jump to that point, and then you get out there. And similar here, if you make if you enter the horizon here, you make an instantaneous jump, and you emerge the other side, and so on, everywhere. So all the antipodes of the black hole are connected somehow. And this, at first sight, looks very odd. From my point of view, this is a topologically non-trivial feature of space and time, which explains the title of the talk. And now, oh yes, this is again a mathematical expression, but you don't have to pay too much attention to it if you don't follow all the math here. This is the Hartle-Hawking state. This is the state Hawking discovered. He said there's particles in region one and particles in region two, all with the same energy, and then there's a factor there that explains that the thing has a temperature T. And according to Hawking, the states in region two are fundamentally invisible. So he says, since you don't see them, you should not include them in your description of quantum mechanics. But then quantum mechanics goes wrong if you do that for an isolated particle. It's all right if you do statistics in a statistical system, but if you have an isolated system, you should not do that. That is basically incorrect. So so we believe that this is not the right way to describe the black hole, but now this two here just means that you are describing the states at the other side of the black hole. And then if you take the whole thing together, the black hole goes into a pure quantum state that we can describe very well. So this could be the resolution of what was the information paradox. Space-time is now topologically non-trivial. So imagine now what would happen to you if you could go faster than the speed of light through the horizon. Well, nobody and nothing can go faster than the speed of light. But in your imagination, you can let a point go faster than the speed of light and ask what happens. And that point re-emerges at the other side of the black hole just like that. So that was this picture here, but now it's the same picture I had before. So when you enter the black hole on one side, you re-emerge at the other side. So the wormhole connects the black hole with itself. But there are some other inversions that take place. Remember that the time coordinate went backwards. You emerge with time inverted. You also emerge with parity inverted. If you look very carefully, you find the left and right are interchanged. If you take the antipolar points of all the points on planet Earth, you get a map of the antipodes. You turn Earth around and look at that map. There's something very strange about that map. You don't recognize it because it's a map of the planet Earth in mirror image, parity reflected. So here, things are parity reflected compared to there. And eventually, there's also particle-antiparticle interchange. So you emerge, but you have particle-antiparticle interchange, parity interchange, and time interchange. That's called the CPT transformation. And that's, for particle physics, that's very important. It has to be this way, because CPT is an exact symmetry in particle physics, whereas C, P, and T separately are not. So there is a very interesting consequence that the Hawking particles that you see here must be very strongly correlated to the Hawking particles sitting there. We call that entanglement. And if ever an experimental physicist can study black holes, that experimental physicist will be able to detect that the outgoing particles and others at opposite sides of the black hole are entangled. And that would be a marvelous experiment, but we can't do experiments with a black hole. They're too far away. We have never even been able to detect Hawking radiation at all. It's all theory. So theoretically, this is a theoretical prediction, that black holes will emit entangled particles, and not just ordinary Hawking particles. So it looks like this then, that the Hawking particles coming out here, they form a certain pattern. You recognize the same pattern at the other side. So the colors are anti-colors. So blue is the anti-color of yellow. This blue line is entangled with that yellow line. And this green line is entangled with that red line, and so on. So all the particles come out entangled at opposite sides. So that's a very peculiar feature of black holes that comes out this way. And so this I've already said, more or less. If you do it wrong, if you would do another identification at the edge of the black hole, you would get singularities. And the problem with general relativity is in general that there's a danger of developing singularities. If you have a singularity, you don't know what to do physically. You don't understand how a physicist could observe a singularity. What would happen there? You can't. You have to apply laws of physics that you don't understand. So we do not want the singularity in our laws about the black holes. If not, then there's exactly only one choice, which is the antipodal identification. So I'll end up with showing what it has to do with space and time itself. So imagine now space and time with the region excavated. That excavated region is a black hole. It might be a black hole that formed in one moment, lived for a while, and then decayed again. So this is actually excavated point of space and time. Also in time, in a time direction, is also a sphere. So that's a virtual black hole. But if you have a virtual black hole, maybe it's surrounded by other virtual black holes, and then you have this situation that space and time are going to look more and more complicated with more and more virtual black holes forming something like a fractal. This is sometimes called space-time form, and it has been conjectured long ago that space and time are basically more two-dimensional than four-dimensional at small distances. Well, of all these things, only the horizons eventually survive. The horizon of a black hole is a two-dimensional surface. So this suggests that at the microscopic level, space and time are two-dimensional and not four-dimensional. So there's some very strange things happening here with space and time. It's not the topology that one might have expected. I don't think that black holes form wormholes that connect different black holes together, because then you violate fundamental laws of nature. But this doesn't violate anything about laws of nature, except it's totally unfamiliar. We have no idea how to work with this. So this last slide should really be considered a speculation. It's the most speculative part of the whole talk. The space and time form a foamy structure. So that's why black holes eventually will modify everything we thought we knew about space and time, but not in the way expected. And this is how we hope to obtain new physics, new laws of nature that explain to us how space and time and matter all interact, how they give gravitational forces and other forces. All these things are related together in one fantastic theory that we still don't know, and we are guessing our way around. And this is how I'm guessing my way around to find better theories of nature. So this brings me to an end, and I hope that that there will be questions and discussion points. Thank you.
Questions, curiosities?